I actually think that the Platonic view is more correct. And I know this is not how most biologists think about things. I think that in the exact same way that mathematicians that are sympathetic to the Platonic worldview, this idea that there are, in fact, in some way, there is a separate world in which various rules of number theory and various facts of mathematics and various properties of computation and things like that, right? That there's a separate space where these things live. And importantly, the idea is that, you know, they think that we discover those things. We don't invent them or create them. We discover them, that and that they would be true still if all the facts of the physical universe were different. They would still, you know, they would still be true, right? I extend that idea in a couple of ways. One is, I think that what exists in that Platonic space is not just rules of mathematics and things like that, which are in a certain sense low agency kind of objects because they just sort of sit there doing, you know, they don't do much. I actually think that there's a spectrum of that, and some of the components of that Platonic space have much higher agency. I think it's a space of minds as well, and of different ways to be intelligent. And I think that just like when you make certain devices, you suddenly harness the rules of computation, rules of mathematics that are basically free lunches. You know, there are so many things you can build that will suddenly have properties that you didn't have to bake in. You know, you get that for free, basically, right? I think intelligence is like that. I think some of the components of that Platonic space are actually minds, and sometimes what happens when you build a particular kind of body, whether it's one that's familiar to us with a brain and so on, or really some very unfamiliar architectures, whether they be alien or synthetic or whatever, I think what you're doing is you're harnessing a pre-existing intelligence that is there in the same way that you harness various laws of mathematics and computation when you build specific devices.
Okay, well, that's super interesting. So at any moment, there's Mike 11, but there's Mike 11 at 11 a.m., then there's Mike 11 at 11:01 a.m., and it's not clear they're the same. So there's the river, do you step in it? This is the same river. Okay, cool. There's a through line. There's something there, though. Maybe it's something like you're akin to what you were an epsilon amount of time previous, and then that's the through line. So as long as that's true, then you can draw a worm of you throughout time. Are you saying that at any slice of that, there was a Mike 11 in some Mike 11 space, which is also in the minds of human space, and you're picking out points somehow? You're traversing this space of minds.
That's actually even more specific than what I was saying. I mean, that's interesting, and I think that's what I was saying, that in general, kinds of minds. So there are different... I don't know quite what to think about individual instances, but kinds of minds, you know.
Because that would be an extremely large space then.
Well, I think the space is extremely large, possibly infinite, but in fact, probably infinite. But I think what I was talking about was mainly types of different minds, types of cognitive systems. Now, for individuals, you raise a really interesting point, which is I call them selflets, which are the kind of the thin slices of experience that
you call them selflets.
Selflets.
Uh huh.
You know? Because you have a self, and then the different slices of it are the selflets, and you can look at it as, you know, kind of like that special relativity bread loaf, you know, sliced into pieces, that kind of thing. So I think what's interesting about asking that question about the self and what is the through line is what's really important there is to pick a vantage point of an observer. Again, kind of akin to what happens in relativity, you have to ask from whose perspective. So one of the things about being a continuous self is that other observers can count on your behaviors and your properties staying more or less constant. So the reason that we identify, oh yes, you know, you're the same person as you were before, is basically, you know, nobody cares that you have the same atoms or you don't, or the cells have been replaced. What you really care about is that this being, I can have the same kind of relationship with them that I had before. In other words, they're consistent. I can expect the same behaviors, the things that I think they know, they still know, and so on. And so that, of course, in our human lives, that often breaks down because humans grow from being children to being adults. All their preferences change. The things that they remember and the things that they value change. In our own lives, we sometimes change, right? And that's a much more important change. You know, are you the same person, even though if all your material components remain the same, but you changed all your beliefs, all your preferences, would you still be the same person, right? So I think what we mean when we say the same is not about the matter of at all. It's about what kind of relationship we can still have, and what do I expect from you behavior wise, and so on. And there's some really interesting, and so that's from the perspective of an external observer. Now the latest work that I just published a couple of days ago looks at what does that mean from the perspective of the agent themselves, and this idea that You don't have access to your past. What you have access to are memory engrams, you know, traces of past experience that were deposited in your brain and possibly in your body that future you is going to have to interpret. And so that leads to a kind of a scenario where you treat your own memories as messages from your past self, you know. The idea then that is that those memories have to be interpreted. You don't necessarily know what they mean right away because you're different. You're not the same as you were, right? Especially over long periods of time. And this comes out very starkly in organisms that change radically, like caterpillars to butterfly. So memories persist from caterpillar to butterfly, but the actual detailed memories of the caterpillar are of absolutely no use to the butterfly. It doesn't eat the same stuff. It doesn't move in the same way. It has a completely different body, completely different brain. You can't just take the same memories. And so I think what happens in biology is that it is very comfortable. In fact, it depends on the idea that the substrate will change. You will mutate your cells. Some cells will die. New cells will be born. Material goes in and out. Unlike in our computational devices, the material is not, you're not committed to the fidelity of information the way that we are. In our computation, you are committed to the salience of that information. So you will need to take those memory traces and reinterpret them for whatever your future situation is. In the case of the butterfly, completely different. In the case of the adult human, somewhat different than your brain when you were a child. But even during adulthood, your the context, your mental context, your environment, everything changes. And I think you don't really have an allegiance to what these memories meant in the past. You reinterpret them dynamically. And so this gives a kind of view of the self, kind of a process view of the self, that what we really are is a continuous dynamic attempt at storytelling, where what you're constantly doing is interpreting your own memories in a way that makes sense about what, you know, a coherent story about what you are, but think what you believe about the outside world. And it's a constant process of self-construction. So that I think is what's going on with selves.
If it's the case then that we interpret our memories as messages from our past selves to our current selves, then can we reverse that and say that our current actions are messages to our future self?
Yeah. I think that's exactly right. I think that a lot of what we're doing now is at any given moment is behavior that is going to enable or constrain your future self. You know, you're setting the conditions in which the environment in which your future self is going to be living, including changing yourself. You know, anything you undertake as a self-improvement program, or conversely, you know, when people entertain intrusive or depressive thoughts, that changes your brain. That literally changes the way that your future self is going to be able to process information in the future. Everything you do radiates out not only as messages and a kind of niche construction, you know, where you're changing the environment in which you're going to live and which everybody else is going to live. We are constantly doing that to ourselves and to others. And so that, you know, really forces a kind of thinking about your future self as kind of akin to other people's future selves. And I think that also has important ethical implications, because once that symmetry becomes apparent, that your future self is not quite you, and also others' future selves are also not you, that suggests that the same reason you do things so that your future self will have a better life, you might want to apply that to others' future selves. Like breaking down this idea that, and I'm certainly not the first person to say this, but breaking down the idea that you are a persistent object, separate from everybody else, and you know, sort of persisting through time, breaking that down into a set of selves, and what you are doing now is basically for the good of a future self, I think makes you think differently about others' future selves at the same time.
Is it as simple as the larger the cognitive light cone, the better for the organism?
Well, what does better mean? I mean, I think that certainly there are extremely successful organisms that do not have a large cognitive light cone. Having said all that, you know, the size of an organism's cognitive light cone is not obvious. We are not good at detecting them. It's an important research program to find out what any given agent cares about, because it's not easily inferable from measurements directly. You have to do a lot of experiments. So assuming we even know what anything's cognitive light cone is, I think lots of organisms do perfectly well, but then what's the definition of success? So in terms of the way we think about, the way many people think about evolution in terms of, you know, how many copy number, like how many of you are there, that's your success. So persistence and expansion into the world. From that perspective, I don't think you need a particularly large cognitive light cone. You know, bacteria do great. But from other perspectives, if we sort of ask ourselves what the point is and why do we exert all this effort to exist in the physical world and try to persist and exert effort in all the things we do in our lives, one could make an argument that a larger cognitive light cone is probably better in the sense that it allows you to generate more meaning and allows you to bring meaning to all the effort and the suffering and the joy and the hard work and everything else. From that perspective, one would want to enlarge one's cognitive light cone. And, you know, I collaborate with a number of people in this group called CSAS, the Center for the Study of Apparent Selves. And we talk about this notion of something, for example, in Buddhism, they have this notion of a bodhisattva vow. And it's basically a commitment to enlarge one's cognitive light cone so that over time, one becomes able to have a wider area of concern or compassion, right? The idea is you want to work on changing yourself in a way that enlarges your ability to really care about a wider set of beings.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.